Hello.
Okay. Wanted to thank everybody for coming out on this cold New England night during the holiday season. It's good to see that we've got a good crowd here. And I just wanted to let you know this is our last program of our educational series this fall, and that we're also in the midst of planning our spring program. And as soon as we figure out the who's going to talk about what, when, and where, we'll put that together in a schedule and fire that off in an email to all of you. So if you haven't signed in up front with Chris, please do so and give her your email address in a legible form so that we can stay in touch with you. Now, I also want to take a minute to thank all of the members on our community outreach team, because they've really worked hard to put this program together, specifically Sheila Tainter and Chris Cernick. You know, all of this that you see here today, coordinating with the speakers and the venues and so forth, and getting everybody signed in, that's all their hard work. And we've also got other members on the committee, like Joe, our videographer back there, has put together all of these presentations on film, and you can see them on YouTube if you ever want to go back in case you missed one. And we've also got our courier, Bill Sargent, Walter Mark, Amber Hewitt, and Conrad Wilman. They're also on our community outreach team, and they've helped to shape what you see here today and what you saw here this fall. So moving on to tonight's program, I also wanted to thank Frank with the Refuge, I forget his last name again, I'm sorry, for allowing us to use this space. It's a great venue, we've got a great screen here, and there's plenty of seating, and it's very comfortable, and also want to really thank him. So anyway, moving on to tonight's program, I had to dig deep, but figured out that I really only have one piece of engineering humor in my repertoire, and that goes back to when I was a grad student, my Greek engineering roommate, who was getting his PhD in mechanical engineering. And the story he told goes something like this, and it pretty much starts out like every joke. So an engineer passes on, and he finds himself before St. Peter at the pearly gates to heaven. And St. Peter looks at him and asks him his name. He reveals his name, and St. Peter goes back to his dossier, starts flipping through the pages, and he locates the man's name and says with a frown, "I'm sorry, sir, but you're on the wrong floor here. They're expecting you way down in the basement." So the man rolls his eyeballs in disappointment and starts winding his way down to the basement, where he enters through the gates of hell and they welcome him in. Well, he's not down there very long when he decides that, you know, the conditions are really bad here. It's really kind of a hellhole. And so he starts organizing a team, and they start working on things, and before you know it, the place has got hot and cold running water. It's air conditioned. And he's got escalators going all over the place, shuttling people all around. And so he's become very popular down there, and Satan likes him very much. So one day, God picks up the phone and calls down to Satan and sarcastically says, "How's it going down there in hell?" And Satan says, "Well, since you sent us that engineer, it's actually pretty good. We've got hot and cold running water, the place is air conditioned, and we've got flushing toilets, and we've got escalators shuttling people all over the place." So God, really angry, and says, "Well, you've got an engineer, that's got to be a mistake. You've got to send him right back." And Satan says, "Well," he says, "you know, it might be a cool day here in hell, but you're not getting that engineer back. He's too valuable to us." He says, "Well, you know, then you know what we're going to have to do. We're going to have to sue you." And the devil smiles back and says, "Where in heaven are you going to find a lawyer?" So, though lawyers will likely be involved, I don't think we're going to litigate our way out of this climate predicament. And rather, what's going to happen in terms of mitigation and adaptation is that this is probably going to be humanity's next big engineering feat that we're going to experience. We're going to have we're going to have electrical and chemical engineers coming up with new sources of energy. We're going to have mechanical engineers designing new modes of transportation. And then we're going to be looking to our civil and structural engineers to figure out what we're going to do about our disappearing coastlines and what to do with all this water that is predicted to come. So without further ado, I wanted to introduce Dr. Paul Kirshen. As you know, he's a research professor over at UNH with the Department of Civil Engineering. and he asked me to be brief, so I won't go through his whole resume, but let me just tell you that I think he's really qualified to talk about assessing our risks and what we should be doing about it.
So far successful. Thank you very much for coming out tonight. Thank you for the introduction. I enjoyed that little story. Engineers are always wary of lawyers, and so it's reflected in that story as well. So I'm going to talk about, for about 45 minutes, about how we can think about adapting to the climate change we're now undergoing. And before I talk about adaptation, though, which is adjusting to the climate changes, I just want to say one thing. First of all, I want to say two things. First of all, the most important thing we can do to adjust to climate change is try to control the rate of climate change. So that means control our emission of greenhouse gases, which means control our use of non-renewable energy. Because if we can control our greenhouse gases, we may only have 3 feet of sea level rise by the end of the century, instead of 6 feet of sea level rise. If we control our greenhouse gases, it may mean we only have a 15% increase in extreme rainfall, instead of a 30% or more increase in extreme rainfall. So the number one step in adaptation is trying to control our greenhouse gases. But because we can't stop climate change, unfortunately, because of the long lifetime of greenhouse gases and the inertia of the climate system, we are going to have to adjust to climate change. But what we do want to minimize the change as much as we can through management use of energy. The second thing I want to say is that though, you know, here in Newburyport you can experience climate change as a local phenomenon, unfortunately the whole world is going to be going through is already going through climate change at the same time. So that means instead of, let's say, an isolated drought in Colorado, well, at the same time we're going to have, you know, major droughts in West Africa. Instead of major floods in California, we're also going to have major floods in other parts of the world. So over the next couple of decades, because of climate change, the whole world is going to be feeling these sorts of environmental stresses, which of course will cause, you know, political and economic stresses. So this climate change problem is truly a global problem. And we always have to be aware of that when we think about what we're doing. But today, this afternoon, this evening, I'm really going to talk about how do you actually do adaptation planning on a local scale, on the size of a community, let's say, of Newburyport. And if you have any questions as I go along, I can't wait till the end, you know, please bring them up. Okay, so I'm going to talk, first of all, a little bit about uncertainty, the uncertainty of the future climate. This is what makes adaptation planning such a challenge. If we knew for certainty what the climate changes were going to be, climate change planning would be a lot easier. But because of the uncertainty of the future climate, it makes planning very difficult. And then I'm going to talk about the process of adaptation, and then I give an example of some work we did in Portsmouth. So, I always start with this. All human and natural systems are sensitive to climate. So as climate changes, the services we get from those systems are going to change. So for example, when they built this building, they worried about heat and cooling. It depends upon the outside climate. When you build a water supply source, you worry about the stream flow of the groundwater. When you build a road, you worry about the drainage. And there are numerous other examples. And of course, the environment, ecosystems, are incredibly sensitive to the climate they're in. So as the climate changes, that means everything we get, everything we depend on from infrastructure, those services are going to change. And of course, ecosystems and everything we get from them are going to be stressed. And so, as I said earlier, because we can't stop climate change, we can't reverse climate change, we've got to adapt to these changes, our infrastructure and ecosystems, because of climate change. And this process is called adaptation. And this is just, you may have seen maps like this before, this is just the area around Plum Island and Newburyport, off the NOAA Coastal Service Center Digital Coast mapping package. and this just sees the blues here that we flooded. If we had 6 feet on top of high tide, which is a little bit more than the present 100-year flood, okay? This might be a 100-year. This might be a 100-year flood in a decade or so. So you see, you know, a lot of natural features and built features in this area are vulnerable to coastal flooding. And of course, coastal flooding is not the only stress you're going to see here. You're going to see higher temperatures, heat stress in ecosystems. You're also going to see increased rainfall and more floods and droughts. Most of my presentation talks about coastal flooding issues, but you can't think about the other things that are going. You have to think about the other things that are going on as well. Okay, so forms of adaptation. So there's reactive, there's proactive, and there's spontaneous. And reactive means that after the disaster has occurred, you take action. So this might be the example of Hurricane Katrina in New Orleans, or Sandy in New York City. Disaster occurred, now they're reacting, they're trying to become more resilient. The other one is proactive. That's taking adaptation actions before the threat actually occurs. And there's spontaneous, it's adjusting as you go along. So ecosystems, if we're lucky, might do some spontaneous adjusting to climate change. But most research has shown that, at least in terms of infrastructure, proactive is a lot more effective than waiting for climate change to occur than reacting to the threats and the damages. And so how do we adapt? Well, you know, in terms of ecological systems, there are some things we can do to help ecosystems adapt. First of all, there's resistance options. And this means that you actually protect the ecosystem from the threat. So a good example of this is when we had all the bad forest fires out in the west this summer, they actually built really good fire breaks around real key trees and ecosystems to protect them from the forest fires. And these forest fires and increased wildfires are actually a sign of climate change. So they actually kept the threat away from really key ecosystems by these fire breaks. The other thing is resilient options. And to do this, we try to make ecosystems as healthy as possible. So to protect our wetlands, if we hope to have our wetlands migrate naturally inland as this level occurs, we need to make sure these ecosystems, these wetlands, for example, are as healthy as possible. We keep pollution away from them, keep development away from them, and so on. So we increase the resilience. The last thing is response options. So that means we can facilitate adaptation of the ecosystem. So again, another example is a wetland. I said earlier, a wetland might be able to actually migrate inland as the sea level rise occurs. But it can only happen if there's nothing behind the wetland to trap it, like a road or development. So we want to keep the pathways clear behind our wetlands so they can move inland as the climate changes. These are things we can do to help ecosystems adapt. Now, in terms of the built environment, and I'm a civil engineer, so the emphasis of my talk is about the built environment. But I also want to point out, though, that so much of the built environment, the infrastructure we use, depends upon a functioning ecosystem. So, for example, when we dump our wastewater into a river, well, we assume that river is going to assimilate the waste. And it only happens because the ecosystems that are built around that river. And also, we built a flood protection plan. We're assuming that a certain level of wetlands will help break up waves and things like that. So there's a strong interplay between successful infrastructure and successful ecosystems. But in terms of the built environment, there are a couple of things we can do. We can accommodate the threat. So in terms of coastal flooding, accommodation means that we elevate buildings, we flood-proof buildings, we have really good evacuation plans and so on. Let the threat occur, but we mitigate the damage from that threat. The other kind is protect. So that keeps, if we keep the threat away, we build a seawall to keep the rise and surge away, for example. And then there's retreat. We can't protect everything. So another strategy is when the threat becomes so large, just move away from the threat, move away from the coastline. And successful adaptation plan is a mix of actions taken over space and time by public and private organizations. So what's that mean? Well, it's a mix of actions taken over space. So that means, say we want to put together a plan for Newburyport. not everywhere do we take the same action. You know, some areas we're going to accommodate flooding, some areas we're going to protect, some areas we're going to treat, and so on. So the actions vary in space, but also they vary in time. I mean, if something is threatened right now, you want to put in place and adaptation planning. But if somebody's not threatened for a couple of decades, you don't need to put it in place right now. And moreover, you might put in a strategy that right now, let's say, sandbags might be good enough to protect your area from flooding, because you only get flooded once every couple of decades. But as sea level goes up, you start getting flooded like once a decade or once a year, you need something more permanent, like a seawall perhaps, or retreat. So it's a mix of actions in time. And the actions can be undertaken by public and private organizations. You know, some actions, regional actions, the government may undertake, but certainly a lot of individuals will be taking action. For example, in Boston, you know, many of the private developers realize that they do a new building, they've got to make it climate change resilient. They've got to put the utilities on the second and third floor, and things like that. They've got to worry about climate change. So really, it's actions taken over space and time by public and private organizations. And so this uncertainty thing, okay? You know, engineering, civil engineering, classically we've always designed for projections. You know, when you build a highway, you worry, okay, how many vehicles are gonna be on that highway in 30 years? You design a bridge, what's gonna be the load on that bridge in 30 years, with more traffic and so on. You know, we have reasonable projections. But with climate change, we have really large projections because of the uncertainty of our knowledge of climate change. And we have uncertainty for two reasons. One is the amount of climate change we get, as I said earlier, depends upon our emissions of greenhouse gases. You know, that's a social, political, economic question. We don't know what that is. We give a high emission scenario or low emissions. The other issue is we just don't know enough about the climate system. We still have major uncertainties in the climate system. And so we develop these scenarios, these possibilities of future climate, but it creates uncertainty. So here's a graph of what might be the increase in global average temperature over the next 100 years. So time's on the bottom axis, temperatures in Celsius is on the upper axis. So without going into details, you can see one low scenario is yellow. That's about half degree above the present by the end of the century. Another plausible scenario is a red line, which is like about 3.5 or 4 degrees above the present. So this is sort of information we're given to deal with climate change adaptation. Someone says, okay, you're worried about temperature? This could be the range of temperature you face in the future. It's a wide range. And then, you know, for sea level rise, it's even more confusing. The upper image is just came out of the new Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change report, Working Group 1, which was released a couple of months ago. So again, time is on the bottom, change in sea level is on the left axis. And so you may not foresee it, but their high level projection is 1.2 meters of sea level rise by the end of the century, which is roughly 3 feet, yes.
Prior slide, AOGCM, what was that acronym?
IPCC? No.
AOGCM.
Where'd you see that?
Down at the bottom on the...
I think it means atmospheric ocean general circulation models.
Thank you.
Yeah, okay, sorry. There's a lot of detail on these slides. I'm not going to cover every point, but if you have a question, please bring them up like that gentleman did. Okay, so that's the uncertainty in temperature. Another certain uncertainty is climate change, the sea level rise. So this is the IPCC, the upper one. They show that by end of the century, they project with their best judgment that by end of the century, we might have 1.2 meters of sea level rise, or perhaps only 0.4, okay? So 0.4 to 1.2 meters is their projection of possible sea level rise by the end of the century from the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, a well-recognized and well-respected group of scientists. Okay, in the bottom is a graph from the U.S. National Climate Change Assessment, U.S. National Climate Change Assessment, which is coming out actually in 2014. So again, it's the same sort of graph, except there you see their upper limit of sea level rise is 2 meters. Okay, so Here we have one scientific body saying the maximum is 1.2, another scientific body saying it's 1. So here I am, like in Newburyport, trying to figure out how much civil rise do we plan for. So again, we just have this uncertainty and even disagreement between two groups of experts. So this makes adaptation planning extremely difficult, this uncertainty of the future. And there are numerous other examples of this uncertainty. Okay, and moreover, we can't assign probabilities to these uncertainties. You know, if we could say it's a 30% chance of 1.2 meters and a 50% chance of this and 10% chance of that and so on, there are decision analytical techniques that we can use in civil engineering to actually come up with a good way to adapt. But we don't have these probabilities, so we have to use scenario analysis. Okay, so how do we do adaptation planning? How do we find strategies? Hi, Rick. Okay, so as I said earlier, we have to consider a range of future conditions of the climate. We have to look at high scenarios of climate change and low scenarios of climate change. We just can't look at one value. We consider a range of conditions. And we have to find adaptation strategies that will work over this range of futures. We need to put together an adaptation strategy that will work whether we have 1 to 2 feet of civil rise by mid-century or 3 to 6 feet of civil rise by end of the century. We need a strategy that will work under both those situations. And there are two kinds of strategies we can look at. One is robust. So we build something so big that it can withstand anything, no matter what the future climate is. But the problem with robust strategies in some cases is that we overbuild them, or you know, we don't need to build them right now, so we're wasting capital and causing unnecessary environmental impacts. So most of the thinking now about adaptation is to build flexible and adjustable strategies that can be implemented over time as the climate changes. So that strategy might be something as simple as, you know, sandbags now, and then when flooding becomes more common, you know, some sort of flood wall or flood proofing, and then finally retreat. It's something that's flexible and adjustable over time as the climate change occurs. And then, I'm not gonna read all this, but the fourth point is, you know, we have to integrate our adaptation plan with mitigation planning. You know, we certainly don't want to do something to adapt to the climate change that's gonna really cause more energy to be used. And climate change, as you know, is not the only threat we're facing for sustainability. I mean, we have population change, land use change, other environmental changes. So climate change plans can be integrated with normal sustainability planning. And last couple of bullet points, you know, like any kind of sustainability planning, adaptation plans can be varied with multiple criteria. If you look at it from social, economic, environmental points of view. And because adaptation is local, it's going to be stakeholder driven. And there are two kinds of actions that I talk about for adaptation. One is here and now, and the other is what I call prepare and monitor. So, example of here and now. Obviously, if you build something along the coast, you want to make sure it's climate change resilient. So one of the best examples is New Spaulding Rehab Hospital in the Charlestown area of Boston, right near the Constitution, so in the old Charlestown Navy Yard. So it's a flat area built on fill and vulnerable to flooding. So they built this hospital, you know, way harder than the present 100-year flood plain, put all the utilities on the roof, they have windows that can open, critical patients are above the ground floor, and also I believe they have enough food and water to survive like 4 or 5 days without any outside assistance. So, you know, the incremental cost of doing this compared to the total cost of the building were very small. So this just makes sense. Build something new, make a climate change resilient. But the biggest challenge is how do you protect existing infrastructure? How would you protect, you know, the vulnerable areas of Newburyport, Portsmouth, Portland, Boston, you know, Washington, D.C., Dakar, Accra, you know, every other coastal city in the world. How do you protect the existing infrastructure and buildings? And that's the process of what I call preparing and monitoring. The best way is another example. This is London, okay? The red is the Thames Estuary. And that gets tidal floods, storm surges, coming in from the North Sea, which is on your right. And it travels up the Thames Estuary, and then it used to flood London. And then I guess a couple of decades ago, they built a hurricane barrier just below London to keep the storm surge away. But they know that the storm surge height is going to grow in time because of climate change. And so not only is this increased storm surge going to threaten downtown London, it's also going to threaten all the communities along the Thames estuary, where right now they have smaller local protection works. So there was a plan put together called Thames Estuary 2100, which you can find on the website. And it's a strategy to protect this area, what they're going to do for the next 100 years. And I'm not going to go into detail again, but the plan is for the first 25 years, you're going to keep doing what they're doing. So localized flood protection works, but they're going to make sure that all future development in the Thames Estuary is consistent with this master integrated plan over the next 100 years to protect the estuary. So they have a plan to protect the estuary over the next 100 years, dealing with all the uncertainties. And they want to make sure that nothing is done in the Thames Estuary that's going to make it difficult to implement this plan in the future. They're going to keep their options open. Mill 35 years, keep doing stuff. But then around 2075, they're going to make a major decision whether to, depending upon how much civil rise has been, whether to build another huge hurricane barrier or continue doing local protection works. And at the end of the century, they're going to implement it. So here's a plan that's, you know, stage in time and in place to protect the Thames Estuary communities in London from future flooding. And the people in the region, know they're going to be protected. They're not exactly sure how they're going to be protected yet or when it's going to be implemented, but they know they're going to be protected because here's a strategy to do it, a dynamic, flexible strategy. And they're going to implement the plan, not on time, but on triggers from the climate change. So this is when they're going to make decisions on when to do things. So obviously they're going to monitor sea levels, storm surges, but also at the bottom, land use, and also attitudes to flood risks, because we expect those are going to change over time as well. So this plan, the implementation of this plan is tied to climate and public values. And it's flexible. So when they implement something, timing is tied to climate change. They can change that if they need to, as they learn more about climate change. They have adjustable infrastructure, which we'll talk about later on. They're safeguarding land for future options. That, to me, that's one of the most important parts of this plan. They're not going to build a lot of things right now, but they're going to safeguard land to put in these options in the future. So in my opinion, like every community, every coastal community, needs to have an adaptation plan like this. Plan is cheap. You don't have to build it yet, but you want to make sure you have a plan in place so as the climate change occurs, you're ready for it. And then, of course, this is going to be coordinated with other projects. Okay. And then a couple of corollaries about adaptation planning. One is, I'll start with the bottom one first, is traditionally engineers have thought about things that are fail-safe. You look behind a levee, you think you're safe from flooding. You live below a dam, you think you're safe from flooding. Engineering's been built, civil engineering work's been built to give people the impression that they're always safe. Now with climate change, we can no longer think that. We have to realize that with these increased stresses, our infrastructure will fail. But if it does fail, we've got to make it safe to fail. And so, for example, the Dutch, they're thinking about how they're gonna control the increased coastal river flooding they're gonna see. So they have plans where they have this credible set of flood walls right now, but they realize eventually they're gonna be over top. Then they're gonna, so it's gonna fail. But when it fails, they already have strategies in place on how they're gonna evacuate the population safely so the population can return, okay? So sort of a new paradigm that I talk about for engineering, thinking about things that are safe to fail. The other thing is it's designed with nature. And I sort of alluded to this earlier, but this is Hampton Seabrook area north of here, and they have a flooding problem. And obviously they've got to do everything they can to keep the barrier beach and maintain those wetlands behind the barrier beach. So they've got to, if they're going to be successful in protecting that area from coastal flooding, they've got to protect the barrier beach and the wetlands and other ecosystems. And I guess this sort of thinking is valid around the world. Okay. So, talk a little bit about this concept of flexible infrastructure. You know, engineers have always built infrastructure that's sensitive to demand. So this is the George Washington Bridge. So on the left, you see the bridge in the 60s, where actually with the Nautilus submarine going underneath it. And the bridge then only had one deck for traffic. But then later on the right, they built two decks to have to handle the traffic. And they did this because when they designed the piers to hold up the bridge, the towers, they built them strong enough to hold two piers. But they didn't build the two piers until they needed them. Same sort of thinking in climate change. We need to have climate flexibility built in, not just demand flexibility. And then I've seen some examples of a flexible infrastructure. So this is a possible seawall in East Boston, Massachusetts. And you can this is school and behind it. And you can see the high tide mark by the dark area on the stone wall. So you can imagine, you know, if you had a 5-foot storm surge, which is a 100-year storm surge, it would flood this school. So what they could do right now is build a flexible seawall like this, and then add on to it over time as they need to protect the area from flooding. And then here's a hospital in Houston, and around it is a wall, which is actually quite attractive. But it's actually a flood wall to keep away from flooding. And then here's a park bench, which you flip it up, becomes part of a flood wall. And then, you know, dunes, right, are flexible. You know, build them up as you need to in the right way, appropriately. You know, flood proofing. You can have something simple right now is just to tarp along the bottom floor, raise utilities and things like this. So the small scale things you can do that are flexible to deal with climate change. Another example, you know, here's the aquarium T station. No, this aquarium T station, right, in Boston, right after Nemo. And you can see they have these, you know, sandbags to protect from flooding. And that's good enough for now. It's not going to be good enough in a couple of decades. But it's nice and flexible. When you have a storm coming, how come the sandbags? And then the Dutch, right? The Dutch are now talking about living with water. So that means in certain cities, they're actually going to clear away areas that the flood water is going and flood them. So try to keep the waters up and try to direct it into certain areas. And you know, one of the areas might be a park, like in the upper image there, that lower image becomes a place to store floodwaters. And the upper image here is a parking garage designed to store stormwater. And they're talking about these sort of concepts in Boston as well. In some of the park, you know, if major flood comes, clear out the parking garages and put the stormwater in the parking garage if you need to. And then a bridge, right? So you can design a bridge so you can, you know, add piers onto it as you need to as the scour increases. So, and then here's an example of a stage strategy. So in the upper case, you know, to protect yourself from out of present to 2050, you might just think of local solutions. So you might think about, you know, local floodproofing, as I talked about earlier. But then, at the end of the century, you may think about more regional solutions and finally retreat. So here's sort of a stage strategy over time made up of flexible actions. And so, as an example, okay, this is a project several colleagues and I did for Portsmouth recently. And it's a good example of a vulnerability and adaptation plan. And so, what's climate adaptation about? Okay, so first of all, we evaluate the changes in climate that are occurring and that are expected to occur. So, what might be the civil rise in the future? And then we link these climate change impacts on the things we value. It's a vulnerability assessment. So, a vulnerability assessment is what happens to the area if we don't take anything, if we don't take any adaptation action. If we don't take any actions, what's going to be the impacts of climate change in this area? How vulnerable is it? And then we identify ways to address these impacts, and then we put together a dynamic adaptation plan to reduce the future risks. Okay, so I'm going to run through these steps that were done for Portsmouth. Okay, so ignore the red dashed lines, okay? This shows in Portsmouth, they're interested in the flooding impacts of the 100-year coastal storm. So we need scenarios of what might be the height of the 100-year coastal storm surge over the next 100 years. We have two planning periods. We actually have three, the present, 2050 and 2100. And so, starting on the left, the elevation above mean sea level of the present 100-year flood in Portsmouth is 11.5 feet. And then you see a lower scenario, okay? So if we only have like 2 feet of civil rise by the end of, if we only have 3 feet of civil rise by the end of the century, we may only have, you know, a storm surge of, you know, 14 or so feet by the end of the century. It's a low civil rise scenario. High civil rise scenario actually gives us a storm surge at 18 feet by the end of the century. So we know somewhere in, somewhere between those two scenarios is what may happen to the 100-year flood in Portsmouth, New Hampshire over time. And then we start looking at, okay, I also want to point out, in the upper right, I have something called climate surprises. We have these nice little scenarios, okay? But we might get a very dramatic change in our climate. We might get a, you know, very, very rapid melting, let's say, of ice in Antarctica and Greenland. And 100-year storm surge may become 22, 25 feet or whatever. So once you put together an adaptation plan, you still have to ask the question, what would happen if we had a major, unanticipated climate change sometime in the next 100 years or so, the so-called climate surprise? I'm not going to talk any more about that, but I just want to point that out, that, you know, you can be able to have nice little scenarios in time, but then you realize it could be an abrupt change in climate. You have to worry about that as well. So we want to look at the impacts in Portsmouth under these civil rise scenarios. But instead of mapping out all five of these points, we just mapped out 3 points. Because if you have too many scenarios, it gets too much to deal with. And so we mapped out impacts 11.5 feet, because that's the present climate, that's the present energy storm surge. We mapped out 13.5, because that's close to the high scenario in 2050 and the low value in the low climate change scenario by the end of the century. Then we mapped out 18 feet to give us the worst possible case. And with these elevations, we mapped out the flooding that might occur. So we looked at buildings, okay? And we're gonna go through this in detail. These are the buildings that would be flooded 11.5 feet. And there's a scale here. The color means like blue is deepest, red is middle, and gold is not that deep. So this is the flooding that would occur to buildings in Portsmouth, New Hampshire, 11.5 feet. And you know, you don't see a dramatic change of 13.5 feet. So again, we mapped these out also for 18 feet, but I'm not gonna show 18 feet. And then we also mapped out key infrastructure identified by the town, hospitals, pump stations, and things like that. And then we also look at the stormwater system, because you know, a lot of their drains are obviously connected right to the river, which is tidal. And the river got very high, the storm drains actually backed up and flood parts of downtown Portsmouth. So we identify areas where their storm drains had strong connections, deep connections to the river. And then we also looked at wetlands, what would happen to the wetlands. So we also mapped out what wetlands would be flooded into the various scenarios. So that made these maps, right? And then we started looking in detail, you know, what does this really mean in terms of these systems in Portsmouth? So we divided Portsmouth into four zones, north, central, south, and then the Sagamore Creek area. Every area, we displayed the impacts. So this is the assessed value of buildings that would be flooded by floods of these various magnitudes, okay? By the various zones, okay? So this is one indicator of the damage. And you see, obviously, the higher the 100-year flood, the higher the value that would be flooded. And then another indicator, and you're not expected to read this, was we mapped out for every infrastructure system that was identified, like a pump station, a hospital, and so on, we mapped out, you know, would it be flooded by a flood of a certain magnitude? And then for wetlands, knowing we mapped them out, we also put together photographs of the way the wetlands were changing over time and the way they would change over time as an indicator to show people what would be happening to the wetlands over time. And then, so this gave us the vulnerability, right? We had the vulnerability of buildings, infrastructure, and wetlands. Three resources very important to Portsmouth. And then we thought about an adaptation strategy. So I just want to give you an example of the adaptation strategy we put together for the North Mill Pond area of Portsmouth. And so this is the adaptation strategy for the infrastructure. Okay, what this shows is on the left is, you know, these various scenarios of civil rise, of 100-year floods we're going to face over time. And the next one is the time period, which you might see that level of a 100-year storm surge. So 11.5 feet is the present 100-year flood. Somewhere between 2050 and 2100, we're going to see a 100-year flood of 13.5 feet. And then sometime after 2100, we're going to see, you know, 18 feet or greater. And so then we put together an adaptation strategy for the infrastructure, to protect the infrastructure and the buildings in that area that is key to these elevations. So for example, 11.5 feet. Well, we know we're going to need a tide gate eventually to protect that area from flooding. So let's plan for it now. But let's make sure the storm drains right now have flap gates on them to keep them from the floods from backing up. Let's also consider, you know, filling certain areas and elevating buildings if they're vulnerable right now to flooding. And we do that now. Then sometime between 2050 and 2100, you know, we actually put in this tide gate and we do more work with the stormwater drains. We ban some structures at lower elevations. And then sometime around 2100, we make the tide gates larger and so on and so forth. But, you know, here is an adaptation strategy for this area. It's over time, it's a mix of actions, and the actions are tied to changes in the 100-year flood. And obviously you can work, you can do this at, you know, any scale you want. We can do this every single foot, as if we wanted, okay? But here is a dynamic adaptation strategy to protect this area of Portsmouth that is flexible, but moreover tied to the future climate change. So you don't have to build this all right now, just build it as you need it. But you want to make sure, though, like in the case of this tide gate, that you, you know, plan to put it in. You don't build it right now, but you plan to put it in there in the future. A couple more slides. So wetlands, we also put together a plan. You know, so if salt marsh preservation is priority, let's see, you know, the city should figure out a way to allow upper migration of the tidal marshes, 100-foot buffer zone for wetlands, and so on. So there's also a strategy here for wetlands, okay? More examples of wetlands protection. And then also, recommendations were made to the town about how they can change their zoning and master plan to incorporate climate change considerations in it, okay? So here was a fairly complete preliminary vulnerability and adaptation plan for Portsmouth that, okay. Now, there are possible enhancements you could make to a plan like this. This is a very first cut preliminary plan. So some possible enhancements. One is you could do a benefit cost analysis of the various adaptation options. So this is some work we did for Hampton Seabrook. And you see, just for example, look at high sea level rise. There's an action there, okay? And then this action is so large that there's zero damages if it's implemented by 2050. To implement that action, it cost $40.5 million. But by implementing that action, you over the 50-year planning period, you're going to do away with like $278.3 million worth of damages. So that's got a benefit cost ratio of like 8 to 1. And then if you do that same action and say getting high sea level rise, going against low sea level rise, you still get a benefit cost ratio of 7 to 1. So what that means, 8 to 1 benefit cost ratio, that means over the next 50 years, every dollar you spend in adaptation, you do away with $8 of damage. And similar benefit cost studies I've done, we see ratios of like, you know, 4 to 1, 20 to 1. You know, adaptation, at least in all the cases I've looked at, has always been results in a positive benefits. Okay. The other thing is, you can look at, you know, vulnerability to humans. So this is a portion of East Boston we're also working. And the lighter colors reflect lower income. And you can see right along the coastline where it's vulnerable, lo and behold, that's where the lower income people live. Okay, so here's an area that is not only the buildings are vulnerable, but also a very vulnerable segment of the population are also very, very vulnerable. And then lastly is you can do more sophisticated modeling. In the modeling we were doing in Portsmouth, we were just, you know, get the elevation 100-year storm surge, and we just assume everything at that elevation that was sticking to the ocean would be flooded at high tide. This is a reasonable approximation, but now we're doing some work in Boston on looking at how you protect the central artery tunnels from flooding. And it's a very complicated process there because the storm surge may have to go over the Charles River Dam, it has to weave through all these buildings, pass all these highways. So we're setting up a dynamic model, which we're applying to the Boston area. And in order to capture the dynamics of coastal storms, you have to model the North Atlantic, which is on the right, and then we go to a smaller scale of like Massachusetts Bay on the left, and then, I don't show this, but then we actually go to a smaller scale, we actually model Boston in a smaller grid. So we use dynamic modeling, I think it's very complicated. And then the other thing I'm doing is, you know, I keep talking about you take an action when the climate change has occurred to a certain amount. You know, in Portsmouth, it's 11.5 right now. When 100-year surge becomes 13.5 feet, you do this. When it becomes 18 feet, you do this. Problem is, when do you know the 100-year storm is now 13.5 feet? So I'm working with a good colleague and friend of mine at Tufts University, looking at a decision analysis approach to figuring out, you know, when you actually have a trend and when you have enough faith in that trend to take action. Because if you take action too soon, you know, you've spent money before you had to. If you take action too late, you're going to suffer more damage than you should. So again, this is some of the trickier parts of adaptation. So I think I'll just conclude. So the first thing is, we're going to continue to control our greenhouse gases, because that determines the amount of climate change we have. And obviously, it's easier to adjust to a small amount of climate change than a large amount of climate change. Hopefully, I've shown to you that adaptation is possible. And last, I want to point out that time is really running out for planning. We only have a couple more decades to really get it right and really be prepared for future climate change. Thank you. So I hope you understood this, and I hope you have a couple of questions. Yes, sir.
How is your planning being accepted by political and other leaders in Portsmouth?
Why don't you ask Rick?
Well, he's
the town planner for Portsmouth.
One of the things that was really interesting about this is that we had a project on the books to redo a causeway and open up the culverts to let water flow more. And this study is, say, you know, think about that again, because that's exactly what you're talking about hygiene. So we were looking for a more natural flow of water, and it turns out that a more natural flow of water may not be a good thing, because it increases flooding in these low-income neighborhoods, or lower income in some other areas. So that's one thing. We're trying to figure out how to put it into our capital improvement plan, but we're also beginning to start our master plan, and we're going to be looking at the zoning things, and some of those zoning questions that you raised about, you know, changing the floodplain zone and so forth. So we'll be looking at there.
Yeah, I just want to point out that, you know, towns, they've master plan and zoning, and every couple of years they updo their master plan and update their master plan. It's a great opportunity to incorporate climate change and institutionalize it. So I see more and more towns when we think about updating the master plan, we think about climate change. So, for example, Boston Water and Sewer Commission, which does the drainage and sewage for Boston proper, they're doing a master plan right now. And so, not only looking at the condition of the present system, we also think about how to incorporate climate change considerations into the system. It's an ideal time to do it. The incremental costs of doing that are very small compared to the master plan. So I think at least around here, there's political acceptance. Yes, sir.
What was the cost of that?
The Portsmouth thing? It was a gift. It was around. I think it was about $20,000, right?
I think it was around 30.
Yeah. But we worked really hard on it.
It's about 75 cents an hour.
Yeah. That's about the price. But we worked really hard on it. But these preliminary plans are not overwhelmingly expensive. Yes, sir.
Do the plans take into account wind as well as the actual motion? I guess.
That's tricky. In Portsmouth, we only worried about still water, storm surge. We didn't include the impacts of waves on top of that, because we judged it not to be that important. But in Boston Harbor, in the Central Artery, we were trying to protect a $16 billion asset. We're worried about everything, waves, all that stuff. And that's why we're using the dynamic model. Yes?
What worries me is that as you walk around downtown Newburyport or almost anywhere, everything around you has been designed on the last 50 to 100 years worth of data. And I'm wondering when the towns are going to wake up and say, we really should reevaluate our drainage, our sewer systems, our infrastructure, to see what it's going to do in the next 50 to 100 years worth of atmospheric rainfalls, storm surge, and everything else. And as I think of that, as you were talking about infrastructure, I'm thinking, Newburyport is just getting ready to design a new quarter mile long breakwater, bulkhead. And I'm wondering if they're using the last 50 years with the data or the next 50 years with the data. But I haven't heard that.
Hopefully they're using the new, 50 years with the data.
It'll be underwater to cover.
Most things, and that information is available. We have scenarios of how much storm surge we're going to have in the future and how much wave action we're going to have in the future, given increased extratropical storms and tropical storms. So the information is out there. There's really no excuse for not using it. Yes?
Can you describe the leadership that exists in those communities that are progressively addressing this issue? Who's driving it?
Rick, who drove it in Portsmouth?
Well, it was probably Peter Ritz, our environmental manager, really, who was the lead on it. And then we were able to apply for and get the grant from NOAA to do the work, which was a big help.
Can you speak up?
Sorry.
Oh, I'm sorry.
We had a grant. We were able to get a grant from NOAA, which significantly reduced the cost to the city. But our environmental planner was really doing the lead on that. We were a person in our planning department who's the environmental planner and sustainability coordinator is his title. Which is sort of an indication of how progressive the city is in that regard. That's really his focus.
What support did he have from the council and the mayor in terms of being proactive?
Well, we have a strong city manager form of government, and the city manager was very much behind us. The city manager has been a very strong proponent of sustainability for a number of years.
You need a champion. I mean, the Boston Water and Sewer Commission is the chief engineer. Other towns that work in, it's the town planner. So you need an advocate there. But once they start looking at the numbers, it becomes pretty obvious you have to do something.
Say just something else. Our public works department is also very tuned into this type of thing. They are very proactive, and they've been looking at a lot of this stuff and floodproofing the pump stations and so forth because they see this happening. Even the areas that aren't along the coast are very much affected by marsh. So we're seeing a lot of impact there. So it wasn't a hard sell.
Yeah, and also, for the Central Artery Tunnel, it's the environmental planners and the engineers you know, they said, we don't want a Sandy here. And Sandy was a big wake-up call for a lot of people. And, you know, Mayor Menino in Boston, you know, one of the first things he said is, we don't want a Sandy here. And that really spurred on a lot of adaptation planning in the city of Boston. Yes?
Are you aware of any workings going on looking at
here?
Oh.
Here.
Are you aware of any work going on looking at public transportation vulnerability? Because I know we were just taking the Boston to Newburyport rail line the other day, and that goes right through marshes.
Right. That's you know,
summarize mass, that so
yeah, the question is what's being done in terms of public transportation and adaptation to climate change, because public transportation is, you know, very important to control greenhouse gas emissions. It's very efficient way to move people, and the answer is it's very interesting. Federal Department of Transportation, and I know the Massachusetts Department of Transportation and the Maine Department of Transportation, and New Hampshire Department of Transportation are really concerned about the impacts of climate change on transit systems, you know, highways, rail, MBTA in Boston, and so on. So they are aware of those impacts. And, they are beginning to do, they've already done, vulnerability and adaptation plans. So they're aware of it. And federal DOT's got some really good stuff going on. They have grant programs and so on. So it's good. Yes, sir.
Can you speak of storm surge, rising sea level? Did you calculate in the amount of water that comes from upland during a storm?
No.
Where are you going to put?
Yeah. For Portsmouth, we did not. In Boston, we are going to look at that. We're going to look at the increased flooding from the Charles River, the Ponset River, and the Mystic Rivers. You know, I think in Portsmouth, there was not a major threat from river flooding, as we understood it. So we didn't have to look at those cumulative impacts. But in a place like Boston, where there's potential for a lot of problem, we have to look at the combined impacts of freshwater flooding meeting a coastal surge. That's a real mess, potentially mess. Yes, sir.
Has sea level rise modeling been done for geographies along the New England coast, or just in specific instances like Boston, Portsmouth, Hampton?
Okay. The question was, has sea level rise modeling been done along the New Hampshire coastline? Let's see. The modeling that was done for Portsmouth was you know, fairly straightforward. We just took the elevation of the storm surge, and anything that's connected to the coast, we assumed that was the flooding that would occur. We call that bathtub modeling for some strange reason. The dynamic modeling has not been done for all areas because it's very expensive. But once you set up a dynamic model for one part, like to model Boston, you have to model all the Gulf of all the North Atlantic. It's pretty easy to provide a smaller grid to, let's say, a smaller community like Newburyport. And it wouldn't cost that much more to do a dynamic model for Newburyport because we've already set up the entire grid for the North Atlantic. But the dynamic modeling is limited for the area around New England. Yes, sir.
As marshes play an important role, does the fact that marshes are overrun with invasive species hamper their mitigation?
I'm not an expert on wetlands, so maybe someone else here might have a better answer. But I know invasive species weaken the structure of the wetland, and we don't want our wetlands to be weakened if they're going to be able to deal with climate change. Does anyone else here have a better answer? Yes.
Yeah, hi, I'm Frank Drzewski, Parker River National Wildlife Refuge. And briefly, just to answer your question, there's a lot of money that's come in as a result of Sandy. The Department of Interior allocated about $100 million to various agencies within the Northeast and Mid-Atlantic regions, and a lot of that is going into trying to build resiliency into wetlands and salt marshes. So one of the key issues is invasive. So there's a lot of modeling going on. There's a lot of invasive treatment that's going on. So that's something that's certainly being looked at.
Yes.
So assume I'm an engineer, but I don't believe in climate change.
Yeah.
And I design something in a city, and I use that model this last 100 years instead of the next 100 years. And then suddenly we've got a problem. What happens? Do I lose my stamp? I get paid for the millions and millions of dollars of damage, potentially.
Okay. Again, someone else should correct me if I'm wrong, but as long as you're designed to the present design standards that are specified in the code for your community, you'd be free from liability.
Okay, so who sets those standards?
Okay, those are set by licensing boards. And this is one of the institutional problems we face, is that the design code does not incorporate climate change. But, okay? But as then a standard, in certain communities, in order for you to get a permit to develop something, you've got to meet the present code, but also you've got to put together a plan on how you're going to deal with climate change. Okay, so it's not coming in through the design, it's not coming in through the licensing board, it's coming in through the planning permitting authority that says, okay, you've met the present licensing standards, okay, based upon the past climate, but in addition, you've got to show us before we give you a permit how you're going to deal with the change in the climate.
Are these community standards or state standards or federal standards?
The ones I've seen have been city standards.
City standards. Thank you.
Yes, Rick.
Just following up on that, I think the town of Hull has a special provision to require an additional foot or so of freeboard above the 100-year flood as part of their permitting process. And that's one of the things we're considering in Portsmouth, and also considering the possibility of trying to map that. One of the struggles we have is that the FEMA mapping is still very conservative and doesn't give us a good sense of what the 100-year flood is going to be in the future. And it really annoys me, people fighting about the flood maps, because they're still very conservative and they're not really giving a true sense of the risk. So I think that of the future risk. And one of the things we're actually going to be looking at is the possibility of perhaps expanding our flood zone beyond what FEMA shows, if we can do that. So if FEMA shows our elevation at 9 feet above sea level, we'll go to 10 or 11 as part of our flood hazard zone, which our flood hazard zone requires additional cautions as part of the building process.
Yes?
One of the previous speakers talked about sea level rising much higher here because of the gravitational forces of the Greenland ice sheet. Do you take that into consideration in your calculations?
No. We have considered possibilities of higher sea levels because of changes in regional circulation. The Gulf Stream slows down. Let's say in Boston, it might give you additional 4 inches of silver rise by the end of the century. We've not considered that, the gravitational impacts on future sea levels.
Second question is the damage that you showed in Portsmouth of $500 million from an 18-foot storm surge, what percentage of the total infrastructure did that involve? Of the total, in other words,
total assessed value?
Yeah, total assessed value.
What was it?
I don't.
Yeah. But as you saw the flooding, it's not huge areas, but a lot of it is a historic area. Some people might say it's priceless.
Yeah, but you didn't show the 18 foot. You only showed the 13 foot.
Actually, I did show the 18 foot.
I don't think so.
I only showed the map of the 13 foot.
Yeah.
I showed the damage of the 18 foot.
You showed the damage of the 18 foot.
18 foot looks pretty bad.
Yeah, I was saying, is it 10% of the total property?
It might be. Because a lot of property in Exeter, in Portsmouth is concentrated downtown. That report is online if you go to the City of Portsmouth website. Yes, sir.
has there been a slowdown of some of the permitting that's going on? It seems like if you go to any CONCOM and you attend a meeting, there's always a certain amount of time spent trying to permit some land that might be wet, and they try to redesignate the wetlands and try to benefit the budget so that the developer can push through a project. And if anything, that's going to just slow down the whole adaptation thing of the idea of migrating wetlands inward or inland.
Yeah, that's a really good question if that hasn't been a change in the CONCOM's applications. I haven't seen that, but I don't work too closely with that. Perhaps someone else in the audience could answer that question. Well, what happens, what's going on with the application rate in conservation commissions? Yes, do you have a question?
Yeah, I'm interested sort of historically in the human factor here. Yeah, I was wondering if anybody's ever made a historical study of plans that were made and then maybe carried out or not carried out when push came to shove, the time to, you know, put them into effect. Because political conditions change, and where the rich people live changes, and all of this. So, you know, anybody can make plans, but then 20 years down the road, nobody's really thinking much, and suddenly when it comes time to do it, you know, has anybody looked into this?
Not that I know of. You know, one of the things you want to do about a climate change plan is, you know, institutionalize it somehow. And, you know, I don't know how to do that. You know, I don't know how to build the plans, but institutionalizing it is a real tricky question. But hopefully if it goes with the zoning or master plan, educate the community, there's a good chance of being put forward, you know, being implemented, I hope. Yes, Rick.
Just to kind of put that in perspective, you know, you talked about, I think it was Portsmouth, you talked about a $40 million investment. Yeah.
That was Seabrook Hampton.
But I remember the amounts in Portsmouth were pretty significant. You know, our annual capital budget is less than $2 million. So
wow.
We were looking, you know, a lot of these things are capital improvements that the city has to pay for. And so it's a matter of trying to figure out how you get another $20, $30, $40 million added to, when your total municipal budget, operating budget is only $90 million, and your capital improvement budget is $2 million. So it's a big struggle. The dollar, although the return might be 8-1, it's hard to figure out how we're going to assess taxes to really get up to that high level.
No, it's a problem, but in some cases, private developers are going to do these things themselves, so it doesn't become a public expenditure. But also, you don't have to implement everything, you don't have to build everything all at once. So as infrastructure gets renewed, you can build it better, and so on. If it gets damaged, build it better. Like New York City, as they redo their pump stations, they're moving the pumps up higher. You know, incremental costs, but it's small, but, you know, it makes sense to do. Yes?
I noticed you used the word retreat a number of times. It's a very negative concept in this culture, particularly.
Right.
What does that mean in the world of civil engineering / planning? Does it mean abandonment? Does it mean turning your back? Or does it mean perhaps something a little bit more creative, which is what I would describe as living lightly on the land?
That's a good point. Retreat to me just means, you know, leaving the area and let the flooding occur. But there's all sorts of ways you can leave the land as you applied. I mean, you can turn it into a wetland, you can turn it into a beach. There's all sorts of things you can do. Or you can live on it lightly, which means, I guess, if a flood comes, you move away from it. If you don't have something permanent there, that could get damaged by flooding. And obviously, a lot of developers don't want to hear about the concept of retreat. But there's no way, as Rick alluded to, that we can afford to protect every, you know, square inch of the coast. Probably have to give some up. Yes?
A good example of that happens today, actually. Some of our friends who lost their house out on Plum Island are talking not about rebuilding, but rather putting a trailer onto
the... Can you speak
the,
up a little?
Yeah, that's great.
So people do adapt constantly to the problems that they face, and so some people who lost their house out on Plum Island, instead of rebuilding the house, are talking about putting a trailer on their land and then being able to move the trailer off the property.
Yeah, that's a great strategy.
And so that's one way to adapt to that.
You know, one of my other great adaptation stories is that there was this farmer in Nicaragua, and he used to raise chickens, but he kept getting flooded, so he switched to raising ducks.
That's a true story.
Yeah,
well, except there's an interesting problem, because I'm on the Newbury Planning Board, and you can't have temporary housing.
Yes.
You know, in other words, the zoning then has become responsive, and that means that the community has to understand that this is a positive, not a negative, and woo. That's a political issue.
Right.
Yes.
No, I mean, I think, you know, from a technical point of view, we know how to do adaptation. It's the institutional political part that is really problematic, just as you pointed out. Yes.
When you said your study was a gift, did you really mean that it was, I mean, how much would it, was it actually 20 or 30?
Oh, it's probably more like, you know, give all the labor we put into it, maybe 50 or 60,000. But,
because obviously that's the beginning, and if,
well, then, yeah, then they've got more, sorry, they have to do more work on it as well. It was the first cut. But, yeah. But,
how much would you imagine the Boston study is going to cost?
Well, no, that's around $700,000. But, you know, you're protecting $16 billion.
Yeah.
And so it's well worth it. But it's a lot more complex study than Portsmouth. But, you know, also, I mean, sorry, this thing's not going to last tonight, but, I think now we can do a Portsmouth-like study for less, because we, you know, gain a lot of experience in how to do these things. So it's tens of thousands of dollars. Because like Newburyport would be like, you know, tens of thousands or less. Yes.
What options does a barrier beach have, like Plum Island, when you talk about 6 feet?
Yeah, you know, I'm not sure I can answer that. I mean, I'm a civil engineer, not a coastal engineer. So, I know it's a very complex situation. That's all I can say. Anything else? Yes, sir.
I'd like to know, as a civil engineer, how often do you use the term stakeholder when referring to people who have an interest in what's going to happen with your plans?
Okay, I'm a civil engineer that works at a university, okay? And I'm also a person that's very interested in public policy. And so I use the term stakeholder, meaning someone that's impacted by a project, whether they know it or not. I use it all the time. Mm-hmm. And I really believe in participatory planning, collaborative modeling, all those terms to engage the public in a project, because that's the only way you're gonna build support for a project, get something that's actually useful for the community.
2 weeks ago, the last session that took place here was about ocean planning.
Oh yeah.
Ocean mapping,
right.
I think would be the better term for it, but they showed a film which may have been 20 minutes or a half an hour long. And that term was used several times.
Yeah.
But anybody who, you know, the people who fish, the people who have recreation, the people who have businesses, anyone, the people who are gonna drill, the companies are gonna drill there,
right.
All stakeholders. In Newburyport, we have a mayor who uses that term repeatedly, referring to the waterfront, anybody with an interest in the waterfront, including the group that is opposed to more development on the, everybody's a stakeholder.
Right.
Now, I get it that term is being used in a general sense to mean anybody who has an interest, but it has a specific meaning which has more to do with ownership, privatization, and development. I mean, it seems to me that I don't have any problem with the what's being said tonight, 2 weeks ago, 4 weeks ago. I agree with the intent, the need, the motivation, all of it. But the language angles us toward, it's almost like we're conceding to privatization. I don't mean to...
I sense your frustration because, but when planners use it, you know, we're talking about anyone that's impacted by the project, again, whether they know it or not. So it's more than just the landowners. It's the people that rent, let's say. It's people that visit it. It's people from outside the region that might care about it. You know, it's obviously the political system. So in theory, it's anyone that has an interest in it, whether it's a property interest or anything else. And I guess, you know, in democracy, we try to consider a whole range of points of views.
Mm-hmm. Take the word waterfront, for example. If you say that you're going to build something on a waterfront, that sounds perfectly plausible. But waterfront is a general term. The Rock of Gibraltar, the Mendenhall Glacier, the coral reefs, all of it, waterfront. You don't build there. And the reason you don't even think about it is because you use the specific term. Well, there's a specific term for the waterfront here and waterfront in Portsmouth, which is floodplain. Turn that same proposal into, I want to build something on the floodplain.
Yeah.
And all of a sudden, you know there's something wrong with it. And if you pay attention to the language that's being, if you take more care with the language, even the prepositions start to light up.
Yeah,
it's not on the waterfront. More correctly, it's in the waterfront. and then better than that, it's under the waterfront.
It's
going to
be a good
answer. That's okay. I remember that. So, anything else? Oh, yes.
Has anyone done any studies, to your knowledge, about the relative cost of adaptation versus retreat? I mean, you're a civil engineer. The cost of new construction, retreat and build new over time, rather than...
You know, I'm sure someone has. But, you know, I don't know a study offhand. But I'm sure they're out there. You know, the U.S. National Climate Change Assessments are going to be coming out in a couple of months, so there may well be a couple of examples in there. Okay, so this was nothing else. I want to thank you for your time and attention.
Concludes our fall program, and I just wanted to let you know, I forgot to mention that we have an interim program in February on the 3rd before our spring series starts, hopefully sometime in March. And what we're doing is we're going to have four panelists, and they're going to be from emergency management departments from four towns, Newburyport, Newbury, Salisbury, and Amesbury. And we're going to present them with a climate disaster, and we're going to see how they react to the scenario that we presented them. And they're going to have this ahead of time, so maybe a little bit of time to think about it. We're going to pull one over on them. But it'll be insightful for you to see how things work behind the scenes, things that sort of happen automatically, how your state, your local government works with state agencies and federal agencies to mitigated disaster that's already underway. So that's going to be on the 3rd, and we'll send out an email blast to remind you that that's coming along. All right. Well, thanks for coming.
Thank you.